That's what we want to look at today. Amen. Now, let's start with the message there, the Great Commission. Praise the name of the Lord. We want to start there on paragraph 7. Hallelujah. This is known as the Great Commission. It was the last words that our Lord spoke. Hallelujah. And the first time he sent out his disciples in Matthew chapter 10, we find that he gave them a commission to go heal the sick, to cleanse the lepers, to raise the dead, and to cast out devils. And he told them, as you have been freely given, as you have received freely, freely give also. Hallelujah. And we know, if you read there, I believe it's Luke chapter 10, if I'm not mistaken. The disciples went with that commission. Hallelujah. And they came back and they were rejoicing. Hallelujah. And they were saying, Lord, even the devils were subject to us. And he said to them, but don't just rejoice at that. But rejoice that your names are written in the Lamb's book of life. Hallelujah. So, you know, the commission goes with power. It takes power, it takes miracles, it takes the supernatural for people to stop and listen to what you are saying. Hallelujah. So we said that on Wednesday, divine healing, miracles, and everything, it's not the main thing, but it's a necessary thing. It's a bait that God uses in order to win souls to himself. Hallelujah. I don't know if you have testified to some people who are deep in their things. I tell you, words alone cannot do it. Hallelujah. Words alone, you can read scriptures for them. You can even, you know, repeat quotations. But brother, sister, it's so difficult for someone who is, you know, busy in their own things. It takes something supernatural. Hallelujah. Let's continue and we will see how the Lord will lead us. Hallelujah. Amen and amen. And the last commission he gave to go into all the world, just continue as they did at the first. And he's just emphasizing it. Heal the sick. Lay hands on the sick. Cast out devils. It's a privilege for me, brethren, to stand with men like you, shoulder to shoulder, in this great fight. Hallelujah. And I want to tell you, and I want to convey this message for you. The time is ripe for us to invade the different corners of Tsakani, Kwatema, Duduza, whatever it is. And you don't have to wait for a church event to testify about the message of the hour. Sometimes you start with your neighbors. Sometimes you start with people at school, Brother Michael. Sometimes you start with the people that you are working with. Sometimes you start with your relatives. Tell them about what God is doing. Tell them about the message of the hour. Hallelujah. And I'm trying to get somewhere here. And when we get there, then we close. Hallelujah. Now, paragraph 8. Hallelujah. Isn't it nice to have a nice projector? Everything is good. Hallelujah. Let's give a hand of praise to the Lord. Once we start taking steps forward, we should never look backwards. Once you start progressing, there is no way of going, there is no backsliding. Let's keep the standard going forward. Hallelujah. Now, the gospel does not only consist of the word only. Hallelujah. I want to make this point, children of God. The gospel does not only consist of the word only, but through power, and manifestation of the Holy Spirit. Because that's the only way it could be done. For these signs shall follow. Yay. Praise the name of the Lord. Would be the word to take life. So it would have to be the Holy Spirit that will give life in the word to produce the signs. You, brethren, you believe that. Hallelujah. Amen and amen. Now, Brother Branham talks in many messages. Just relax, I'll tell you where to go to the next slide. Hallelujah. He talks in many messages how God, led him to do missionary work. At one point, the Holy Ghost came and told him exactly where to go. He says, go to Africa, and then from Africa, go to India. Hallelujah. And it's very important that we listen to the voice of God. Hallelujah. Because when God is sending you somewhere, when you don't do it, then you are in trouble with the very same God that sent you there. So there was a brother who was managing his meetings. So that brother didn't quite like Africa. So he says, Brother Branham, I think let's go to India. Let's forget about Africa. Hallelujah. God didn't like that. And I believe after those meetings in India, then Brother Branham took sick. Hallelujah. He was so sick, and he even told Billy Paul that, I don't even know whether I will make it until tomorrow. That's how sick he was. And while he was praying there, the Holy Ghost came in the room and he says, didn't I tell you to go to Africa first? Then India. Hallelujah. So you see, the commission of God can even put you into trouble. So I want to tell you, church, that we are also carrying the same commission. We are supposed to take this message of the hour. We are supposed to take the message of the resurrected Lord Jesus Christ into these people of Tsakan. Hallelujah. And what if I told you that they are waiting for us to come? Hallelujah. What if I told you that that's the reason why God has put us in this place? To save those souls that are savable in this area. I, for one, I don't believe that everybody that we see is serpent seed. No. Do you know that some people who are in taverns, some people who are living the most horrible kind of a life, those are the ones that are supposed to be sitting on the empty chairs here. Never judge a book by its cover. And, I understood it when Brother Branham was saying that certain people, the things that they say on the outside, it's not really what they are on the inside. It's just that they are yet to see something real. Hallelujah. You know very well that the reputation of Christians is not good out there. Hallelujah. I'm only proud to be a minister when I'm among people like you. You know me. Hallelujah. You know what kind of a person I am. But when you go out there and you say you are a preacher, mfundisi, people look at you because they judge you with the things that have been in the newspapers. Hallelujah. They judge you because of what they've seen on television. When we say God heals, when we talk about a testimony, they think it's all fake. Because people out there, they manufacture testimonies. It's a healing and it never took place. Hallelujah. That person never was sick. There was a time when, cameras were even taken to a corpse. It was supposed to be a corpse. It was a box. And someone was lying in there and that person was faking to be dead. And it was everywhere. And then the pastor says, you come up, come back to life. And you know, such things, they bring a bad name on us as Christians. Hallelujah. And I tell you, there are people who are staying at home. There are people who are not coming to church because they are so tired of the things that are happening within the churches. This one, I can't preach it outside. I can only preach it here. There are good people that are not coming to church because they've been disappointed. Men can't send their wives to church because when they send their wives to church, the pastor takes over being the husband now. Hallelujah. People can't even offer because monies are misused in church. Hallelujah. Jesus fed 5,000 people. The ministers of today, the bigger the church, the good it is for them. Because all those people are going to be feeding them. Shouldn't be that way. Hallelujah. Tithing is a Bible principle. It's so good, I preach it and I believe it. But some people don't tithe because they've put their money in the wrong hands. God bless you, Brother Nguna. I know what that means when you raise your hand like that. God bless you. But people have put money in the wrong hands. Hallelujah. The money didn't reach God. Hallelujah. Tithing is a revelation. Hallelujah. If you are a Christian and you've got a confidence with the ministry that, and you can see that it's God ministering to you, you know what to do. Hallelujah. You know what to do. And if you don't have confidence, go to a place where you have got what? Confidence. Hallelujah. Now, I want to talk about what happened in India. Hallelujah. So that we can understand what we are talking about. Don't worry about the quotations. I'll come back to that. Amen. So, I won't mention names. We are online, eh? Huh? The network is not good. All right. So, but you're recording. All right. Still, I won't mention names. So there was an evangelist, hallelujah, a renowned evangelist. He went to India to preach the word. And when he went there, the people came and he was telling them how Jesus is good, how the Bible is the word of God. Hallelujah. And there were other religions there, the Mohammedans, and I think there's another religion there that is quite great in India. Amen. So they started to say that, you people, you brag so much about Jesus. But Jesus is just like our own Muhammad. He has got good words and Muhammad has got good words. Hallelujah. And then the brother said, no, but Jesus is resurrected. And they said, where is he? Then he says, no, he's in my heart. He says, even also Muhammad is in our hearts. What is it that can prove the difference? And then they started bringing sick people. And, you know, Brother Branham says, that evangelist, he had to look for the next flight back home. One, he couldn't even stand the challenge for the sick people because the organization that sent him there, they don't believe in divine healing. So he realized that if I go into this area here, one, I might not get the results. Number two, my sponsors are going to turn back on me. So he took the next flight back to America. Hallelujah. And it was the time for Brother Branham to also go to what? To India. Hallelujah. Brother, sister, I want you to catch the revelation that I'm having. And I believe that if you catch the revelation that, you know, there's something that, you know, that happens when we are together. And when I say together, not just in one place like this, but when we are together in hearts, together in prayers. Like how you sisters, you've got a big challenge. The way these brothers are so united. We've got our own group, the Men Fellowship. We are planning things. We are planning things. The way we are so united. Hallelujah. I tell you something. Anyway, let's continue. Brother Branham went to India. Hallelujah. And when he went to India, what happened? He meets those Mohammedans. Hallelujah. He meets those Mohammedans. I think just increase the volume for me here. Yeah? Even our system is kind of misbehaving today. I think switch it off. It's not on. Eh? Yeah. Praise the Lord. Much better. Hallelujah. So he was met with the leaders of the Mohammedans and the different religions of India. Hallelujah. And they thought that they could embarrass William Branham the same way they had embarrassed the other evangelist. So they came to him and say, "Ah, you Americans, it's just psychology. You are just talking about words." Hallelujah. "You are just talking about verses. You are just talking about quotations. We also have good verses. We also have good quotations. We also have even wonderful people more than you have." And you know what? Brother Branham admitted to say, "Yes, they are right." Hallelujah. They also have good people. They also have wealthy people. Hallelujah. So, he started talking with them. And I like this statement that he makes. But it's a very sensitive one. But I will just share it. Hallelujah. He says, "I had a meeting with the witches. I had a meeting with those Mohammedans and everything." He says, "I could have a proper discussion with them than when I meet other ministers." He says, "I felt better talking with witches, talking with these Mohammedans, than I would do with other ministers of the gospel." May God help us. Hallelujah. I think that's an indictment on the ministers. Our attitude must be right. Amen. A minister is not supposed to be brawling and fighting with everybody. Midnight Saturday, you are supposed to be preparing for Sunday. You are busy fighting with everybody. Huh? Can I tell you even more? Can I tell you more? And I'm also a minister, and may God help me. I want to be a minister that is God-fearing, that is loving, that is for unity, that is for peace, that is for progress. Another brother told me that if we could have a convention and we put all the saints in one big hall, there will be sweet fellowship. Brothers from this church, sisters from this church, greeting the other pastors, brothers from that church, sisters from that church. There will be sweetness of fellowship. He says, you take ministers and put them in their own room, you have to call the police. But the brothers, they will be in fellowship. It will be a sweetness of fellowship. May God help us. Something is wrong somewhere. Then I understand, Brother Branham says, don't come behind the pulpit for a wrong reason. He says, the qualification for standing behind the pulpit, you must be at the burning bush experience somewhere. Where God cleanses you, where God purifies you with the fire. You see, Isaiah, before he could become a prophet to the nation, to the whole world, a prophet who could write 66 books, which is the entire Bible. And Isaiah goes before Genesis. He picks what was happening in heaven, the fights with the devil and whatever. He goes to the coming of the Lord. He speaks about the birth by a virgin. And he speaks about the second coming. He speaks about the millennium. Hallelujah. But if you go to Isaiah chapter 6, amen. Isaiah goes to the house of the Lord to worship. Hallelujah. As he goes to the house of the worship, he kneels on the altar and he sees a vision. He sees the temple of God. And, you know, when he was in the presence of God, he started to condemn himself. When you are in the presence of God, you don't condemn the other fellow. You see how bad you are yourself. And he says, "Woe unto me." If you read the book of Isaiah from chapter 1 to chapter 5, he's saying, "Woe unto them, woe unto them, woe unto them." He's fighting everybody. But chapter 6, the fingers, because when you say, "Woe unto you," the other fingers, they are pointing at you. In chapter 6, he now started to say, "Woe unto me. I am a man of unclean lips. I'm undone. And then the angels from the altar came and they didn't purify him with water. They brought fire. And then they purified him with fire and they said, now you are clean. Brother, sister, it takes the fire of the Holy Ghost to clean a believer. Hallelujah. How many of us want the fire of God to clean our eyes so that we can only see things that are lovely only? How many of us want a clean thing of our lips? You know what unclean lips are? They talk about all the little bad things. Amen. Aye, but God help us. Amen. Now, back to India. Are we there in India? He says, I had sweet fellowship with the witches, Brother Bernard. Hallelujah. He says, my fellowship with them was better than I could have with the fellow ministers. And they started telling me, you people, you Christians, you are always claiming big things. But, and I've seen it, né? Always claiming, God is good. Our God is so big. If he's so big, what is it that is doing that is big? Don't tell us about what he has done in the days of Moses. Don't tell us about what is done in the days of William Branham. We want to see how big he is today. Hallelujah. And you know what? I'm sorry. I'm online, but I'm going to mention it. He says, the things that those people were telling me is just the same that we find in our denominations. The Baptist wants to convert everyone to be a Baptist. The Pentecostals want everybody to become a Pentecostal. He says, but where is the reality? It's not there. Hallelujah. And they were cornering Brother Branham and telling him that you are just like dogs barking at the wrong tree. That's a big statement, ne? Dogs barking at the what? Wrong tree. What does it mean? It means that, you know, for people, maybe the elders in here would understand. We used to take our dogs to go and hunt. And then if the dog is starting to bark and it's going at it, then we think that, yeah, that rabbit, I think it has gone there. Then we follow that dog and we find that this dog is just playing with us. There's nothing there. That's where the statement comes from. Barking at the wrong what? Tree. Hallelujah. Then as they were doing that, Brother Branham says, I was praying in my heart to say, Lord, give me an opportunity. Give me an opportunity to prove that you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. He says, as they were talking and talking, suddenly there came a blind person who had been blind for about 20 years. And he had been blind because the same leaders of these witches and whatever, they had told him that in order for you to find favor with God, you must worship and your eyes must be open looking at the sun from morning to evening. Hallelujah. Hey, some of these things that we are told to do. He was told, yeah, for God to have favor with you, look at the sun from morning to evening for I don't know how many days. And the poor fellow did that. And what happened? He went blind. And now the very priest that led him to do that, they are nowhere to be found. They can't help him. Brother Branham says, yeah. He says, while he was talking like that, he says, he saw a vision. Hallelujah. Amen. Someone say amen. Amen. He saw what? A vision. Knowing that it's written in the Bible, we shall open the eyes of the blind. It's wonderful. But brother, sister, there has to be a supernatural element to it. He says, I saw a vision and I saw this man here that he had been blind for about 20 years. And the reason why he was blind, it was because of these ministers that he was with. they taught him to say, look at the sun. He says, but in the vision, I did not see him blind. I saw him jumping up and down. He was healed. He says, brother, I was seated in a corner, but when I saw that vision, I stood up and I said, yes, gentlemen, let's continue talking now. What did the vision do? The vision gave him perfect faith. He says, I couldn't continue with the discussion. If God had not shown me the vision, I would not have continued with the discussion. Hallelujah. Brother, when God has revealed something, it gives you perfect faith. You know that whatever you are going to go through, you know the end from the beginning. Hallelujah. That's why, my brother, my sister, we must be so close to God until we see the thing conquered. We must be so close to God that before we have an answer, before we know how it's going to happen, we know already that we have overcome. Brother, this afternoon, Sister Beulah, I'm so happy this afternoon because I know that we have overcome already. I'm not looking at here. I'm not looking at where we are. I'm not looking at October 2023. I'm looking at the vision there. I'm looking at the end result there. The result is that we have overcome. We have overcome the devil. Hallelujah. It ought to encourage every sick person. It ought to encourage you, Sister Wata. We might look at you and say you are sick today, but we are not looking at this year. We are looking at the testimony that is ahead of us. Hallelujah. We are not looking at the condition where we are. Hallelujah. We are not looking at the number that we are in here. I know that we are going to have a problem with a few chairs and more people. Hallelujah. I'm looking at the end. So Brother Branham was no longer looking at the person was right here. Blind as blind could be. But Brother Branham was looking at it in a different way. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Oh, my brother, sister. Hallelujah. I'm not looking at where we are. I'm looking at where God wants us to be. You say, brother, have you seen a vision? Let me tell you something. The moment you open your Bible and you start to read your Bible, I mean, you are looking into a vision. Hallelujah. That's why we were saying on Wednesday, read your Bible every day. Read your Bible every day and pray every day. That's the way to overcome. Now, Brother Branham had seen a vision. He had seen this man that God had healed him and the eyes are perfectly fine. Now he started to say, now he says, brethren of the different religions, you entertained me the whole afternoon. I thank you so much. The fellowship was sweet. But I'm here to tell you that Jesus Christ and the religion of Christianity is the only true religion. And the people, they said, oh, there's Muhammad, there is Buddha, there is what and what. He says, no, gentlemen, I know what I'm talking about. And he says, of course, I couldn't have said that if God had not shown me the vision. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And he says, yes, I see the Mohammedans, you are here. I see the Buddhas, you are here. Here is a man. 20 years ago, he had his eyes wide open. But you told him that he must worship the sun. And that's the first error. Saints, are you listening to me? The first error is that this man was taught to worship the creation. The sun is not a god. The sun is a creation of a god. So you don't worship the creation. You worship what? The creator. Mistake number one. Number two, he is blind. So if you say your religions are the best, I don't have to argue with you. Here is the man. Come pray for him. Let the God that can open the eyes of this blind man that you all know, this one is not a scam. I didn't bring this blind person from America. He is your brother. He has been blind for 20 years. Let's start with the Mohammedans. Hosan. The imam was there. And he looked at his juniors. The juniors are looking at him. Say, go there. He says, hey, this one is a tough one. I don't want to embarrass myself. He looked down like that. The Buddhas were there. Brother Branham says, it was the most quiet congregation that I'd ever seen. And remember, there were more than 30,000 people in that meeting. Hallelujah. More than 30,000 people in that meeting. Hallelujah. And he says, after he says, okay, let me ask the interpreters to put it in your language. Maybe you didn't hear me. I said, anyone who has got a confidence with his God, that you can open the eyes of this one, come and do it. Remember, even the other evangelist, he had run away from such a thing. Here is a man who knows his calling. Hallelujah. He says, it was the quietest bunch. If a 5 rand can fall on the floor, you could hear it from that side. People were quiet. Hallelujah. Then he says, yes, ladies and gentlemen, even myself, I can't do it. But Jesus Christ, who died on the cross, whose servant I am, has told me that this one is going to be made well. Brother, they were saying, okay, we have failed. We want to see what your God is going to do. Hallelujah. And he just went there. He didn't even scream. He didn't even take a big Bible and put it on the blind person. No. Evil spirits are not cast by power. It's not your strength. It's the authority. The demons, they recognize authority. He just went, you know, Brother Branham, huh? There's a great man there in our country, in Zimbabwe. Hallelujah. He passed on, I think, a month or 2 months ago. He lived in the times of Brother Branham. His name is Apostle Ezekiel Guti, a leader of a big organization, a Christian organization. So he says, when William Branham came, he says he just walked in the podium. He says there were plenty of us. And then he just said, yeah, too many devils here. He says, too many evil spirits. He says, let's bow our heads to pray. He says he prayed for less than a minute. And demons were coming out of people. Everybody was falling. And by the time he said amen, he was gone. People slept for I don't know how long, and people were just sleeping like that. Under the power of the Holy Ghost. And when he would pray for someone who doesn't speak or who doesn't see, he would just make a simple prayer. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I give you your sight, or I do this. He would never make it an issue of physical strength. Because it's not in the muscles. Like people think when you read about Samson, you think Samson was going to the gym and he was a strong man, a steroids or whatever, whatever. No. Samson was just like Michael or Sibusiso. It was not the strength, it was not the muscles of Samson. Otherwise, it would not be a paradox. He was just a tiny man like Sibusiso. But the paradox was when the Spirit of God comes, then you find Michael lifting the whole building like that. Then you find Michael tearing up a lion. It was not the strength of Michael. It was the strength of the Holy Ghost. So he just prayed for that blind person. Hallelujah. And by the time he said amen, what he saw in the vision. Hallelujah. The blind man was running and screaming and praising the Lord with a simple prayer. Brother Norman, it doesn't take our strength. It just takes the power of the Holy Ghost. And when he did that, you know what happened? He just stopped and he says, now, my God has done this. How many of you are willing to take the name of the Lord Jesus Christ? How many of you are willing to become Christians? He says there was a stampede. Just one power demonstrated, one healing. It was accompanied by about 30,000 souls coming to the Lord at one go. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise be the name of the Lord. He says they were coming. They wanted to hug Brother Branham. They wanted to carry him. It had to take the police to take him away because the people were just coming. Everyone with a problem. They said, if I can touch this man. Yeah, it was chaos. But look at one healing. The impact that it did. That's why I'm saying here, it takes power, it takes signs and wonders for people to listen and say, what is happening here? Those people, when they saw that, Brother Pio, it also happened there in Durban. Hallelujah. There was a Zulu man. He was kind of bewitched and he was walking like a dog. And with a name that would be difficult for some of you to pronounce. And later on, Brother Branham from America to pronounce that. Hallelujah. Brother Branham comes, rest fields in Clayview. Is it Clayview, that area in Durban? I don't know whether it's still called that. Just read it from the quotes. Amen. He says, it was packed with people. And then, you know, when Brother Branham was doing discernment in America, you say, you are Mrs. So-and-so, you stay at a number so-and-so street, Banban. Amen. But when he was there in Durban, one, he can't pronounce the name of the person. The person is walking like a dog. He's been bewitched. And the name is complicated for Brother Branham to pronounce it. He says, your name is such and such. And he starts repeating. Spelling it out to say your name is N-D-H-L-O-V-U. Glove. He's a white man. He can't speak Zulu. When he wants to say Zulu, you hear him saying Zula. Huh? Praise be the name of the Lord. And he prayed for that fellow. Hallelujah. And the man stood up upright. And what happened? There was a repeat of what happened in India. Many souls came because of that healing there. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. So you see, brother, when God wants to make noise, when God wants to convert people, he does something that is extraordinary. And by that something, many souls, they come to the Lord. Hallelujah. Let's get to something here. Let's go to the message paradox. Amen. You love the Lord? Could it be that we are speaking about things that we're going to see in our lives? Hallelujah. Could it be that God can be so gracious? He comes and he does something supernatural to get the attention of Satan. Me, I believe it. If you believe it, say amen. Amen. Now, we are back to another fellow. The prophet refers to him as an infidel. Hallelujah. What is an infidel? It's someone who publicly declares that there is no God. Hallelujah. When I was still teaching in Soweto, I met someone like that. Publicly, they are proud to tell you that you people, you are wasting your time. Prayer, what is that? They laugh at it. When we are doing assembly and we are praying there, they go, they bang their doors and they go to their offices. say this is a white man's religion. It's nonsense. Hmm? So it's not only black people. There are also white people like that. Amen. So I'm going to refer to this one, the infidel. And I'm going to take it from the message, paradox. Hallelujah. You know what? I'm believing what I'm preaching here. I'm believing that God is going to give us exactly what we are reading in the spoken words here. Hmm? On Wednesday, for those who are not here, I encourage you to go and listen to that message. But we were talking about the vision at Macedonia. How many of us remember that? How Paul saw a vision, and a brother in Macedonia said, "Brother Paul, come help us here." And Paul immediately left everything and he rushed to Macedonia. And God did great things there. Amen. And then Brother Branham, in his prayers also, God showed him a vision of a little lamb that was crying. And as he kept on listening to it, he started to hear, Milltown. And we know that it was Georgie Carter. Suffering from TB for 9 years until the legs were just like broomsticks. Hallelujah. And how God led Brother Branham to Milltown there. There was no church, and they found a church that had been abandoned with some quarry on the side. But the doors were locked. Hallelujah. You caught it, brother. With some quarry on the side. And the doors were locked. And Brother Branham went on his knees. And he started praying. Until within 5 minutes, someone came and he says, are you looking for keys into this door? I have them here. Hmm? There is a man who can turn on the light. Hallelujah. What I'm preaching, I believe it. Amen and amen. So, we are talking about this infidel. So, the infidel is the one that the statement I was taking about. Do you have it? Yeah. Paradox. I think it's paragraph 41 or so. So, he said, they are backing up at the wrong tree. And what is he referring to? He's referring to ministers. Because this man, he had created a reputation that he doesn't believe God. He has no respect for pastors and ministers. He believes that they are just making a lot of noise. Empty vessels. Amen. And he says they are barking at the wrong tree. There's nothing called God. They claim to have something. But you never see it. In other words, he's saying, ministers are always saying, God is going to do great things. God is going to do that. And it never happens. Hallelujah. And he says, they are always talking about something, but can produce nothing. What a criticism. And sometimes it's genuine criticism. I tell you, he had seen that. People claiming, you know, when we go out into the world, we must have something. You know, when Peter, James, and John went to the Temple Beautiful, they had something that they had. They had been to Pentecost. They had been filled with the Holy Ghost. And when they went to pray there, they were having the Holy Ghost in them. And the person was looking for money. And they said, no, money we don't have. But what we have, we give to you. Rise up and walk. And the person rose up and started walking. That's where we have that song, limping and praising the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen and amen. Then he says, it was Brother Woods and Brother Branham, they had gone there to hunt. So I'm going to paraphrase it on time account. They'd gone there to hunt. And Brother Woods, he knew that this man is an infidel. So they talk and said, never mention anything about church. Never mention that this is my pastor or whatever. So they went there. They were given, a chance to hunt. But before they could hunt, this man was talking. And Brother Woods forgot the arrangement, like what Brother Nguna did yesterday. Amen. He forgot the arrangement. God bless you, Brother Nguna. We were taking our things to go for a revival. Now, Brother Nguna is taken in the corner. Are you really going for a revival? And after the revival, are you coming back? Brother Nguna says, we are not coming back. We were trying to manage it nicely, but Brother Nguna just went straight. And it solved the problem. Amen. So, Brother Woods, he forgot and he says, Pastor, come out of the car, let's go in the hunt. And the infidel says, Woods, what did you say? He says, I said, this is my pastor. He says, Woods, do you mean to tell me you have become so low that wherever you go, you have to carry a pastor along? Huh? Like people, people call me, some people who have got businesses, they call me to their places when there's trouble. They say, Pastor, come pray. Brother Muri, God bless you. Pray, there's a situation here. And other people who don't believe, they say, Brother Muri, as old as you are, you carry a preacher with you everywhere. When you're in trouble, you're crying, Pastor. But we pray, and God answers the prayer. The child is sick. Someone is sick in the house. Someone is about to be operated. You hear someone say, no. Before this happens, I'm going to call pastor. And people say, hey, leave these things to the doctors, man. Why do you want to include preachers and pastors and whatever? But the prayers of the saints, they avail a lot. Amen. Operations that were supposed to happen, they stop. Things, deaths that were coming into families, they stop because of prayer. Hallelujah. Our brother, I trust prayer. Hallelujah. I'll be like Brother Woods. Wherever I want to go, Pastor, I'm going to Cape Town. Please pray for me first. Is your pastor a pilot? He's not. But he can pray. And you have a safe journey. You understand? Hallelujah. Then he says, Woods, why have you become so low down that even when it's hunting time, you drag your pastor along? He says, that's the way it is. And then this man started to say these things to Brother Branham, to say, you are like dogs that bark at the wrong tree. You ministers, you have nothing. You are just lying to the people. You are doing this thing to take money from the pockets of the people. Hallelujah. You hear someone saying that they don't have any experience of leading a church. You can ask me, I'll tell you more about it. Hallelujah. If we were in this for money, we would have run away a long time ago. This is not an enterprise. This is not a profit-making machine. We are in this because of the passion, because of the calling. Something that you are in, you will support it with your last cent. Even if it means you will remain with nothing. Hallelujah. I like that. Amen. Hallelujah. Yeah, church, we are getting there. Let's just hit this and we close and we go. But we are getting there. The atmosphere is very, very wonderful. Amen. Hallelujah. And then he starts to say to Brother Branham, you are like dogs rushing, barking at the wrong tree. And I've analyzed you ministers. There's just nothing. But, do you hear the but? It's coming from who? It's coming from the infidel. He says, but there is one preacher I would love to meet. Amen. I don't believe God. I don't believe in miracles. I don't believe anything. But there is one minister I want to meet. And Brother Woods kind of knew who that minister was. So he's looking at Brother Branham. Brother Branham says to Brother Woods, hey, keep it low, keep it low. What does he say? Let's go to the next slide there. He says there was a minister that came across the other side where they were staying there. He says there is one of our neighbors who was dying with cancer. And I had been in hospital until, you know what the doctors do? They can come to a time where they say, now you have been so sick, we can't help you at the hospital. We are taking you home so that you die among your loved ones. It's a bad situation. Eh? So this woman who was suffering with cancer had come to that level. Praise the name of the Lord. And then, you know, the community, they were just waiting. We are waiting for the time of God. This, our sister, is going. There's nothing that can be done. The best doctors have... And then there happened to be a revival in that area. And Brother Branham was preaching in that area. And he was there on the pulpit. He had never been to that area. He just said from the pulpit, "Thus says the Lord." And he's looking at the sister who is sick at home. That woman who was having cancer was not even at home, Sister Lind. Was not in the meeting. But there's another sister who is related to that one. She's in the meeting. He says, "Thus says the Lord, take the handkerchief that is in your pocket. You put it in the pocket in the morning." So Brother Branham is not even seeing the handkerchief. He says, "When you were at home, you took a handkerchief and you put it in your pocket. Take that one. That you put in your pocket when you left home. Take it out. You took it out from the top dresser drawer." Brother Bernard, what is that? It's a man who can see what you're doing at home this morning. Which drawer you opened? He says, not the bottom one, the top one. And there was a handkerchief in there. Take it and go put it on the what? On the woman that is sick. It was a white handkerchief. Hallelujah. Huh? Hey, the details. Hey, my man. Someone say praise God. Hallelujah. This is the kind of a God I believe. You put it in your pocketbook when you left home. And you took it from the top drawer, that little handkerchief, with an initial in the corner of it. The details. The handkerchief had an initial. If it was Sister Lindy, it had Sister L. Sister Lerato. Sister Lindy. Sister K. With an initial. Now, this is not Geshwe. White handkerchief with a blue initial. Take that handkerchief and lay it on the woman in the name of the Lord. She will get well. Hallelujah. And spoken word readers, you know there's a brother that you normally hear in the tapes who's always shouting, "Hallelujah! Praise God! Hallelujah!" His name is called Brother Ben. Brother Ben believed Brother Branham so much that if he just hear Brother Branham saying, "Thus says the Lord," he is already documenting the testimony. So Brother Ben went and says, "Oh, this is the sister." He says, "Sister, we are escorting you home. Where is that cancer person?" They went together. He says, "Put the handkerchief." We know what when Brother Branham says, "Thus says the Lord," it's going to happen. They went there. And when the handkerchief was laid there, the woman jumped out of bed. And Brother Ben was there. He started hollering and preaching there. And it was like, Brother Branham says, it was like they brought the Salvation Army there. Hallelujah! Thank you, Lord! Thank you, Jesus! Thank you, Jesus! Hallelujah! Thank you, Lord! Praise the Lord! Hallelujah! The noise, the amens of Brother Ben disturbed the community. The community, they thought, that woman has died. So the whole community, they say, let's go and hear. Who is shouting hallelujah? Glory! Praise the Lord! Hallelujah! The whole community, see how God does it. The whole community says, who is making noise there? Including the infidel. They ran there to say, let's go and check what's happening. When they arrived there, the woman whom they all knew was supposed to die because of cancer is making them food. He's greeting them. He's eating food. And Brother Ben, may God make me a Brother Ben. Hallelujah! Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Our God is a healer. Our God is a savior. Praise be the name of the Lord. So, the infidel who didn't believe God, this time he was defeated. He says, these people, they know what they are doing. Then he says, I don't believe the others, but this one I believe. And he raised his hand up in the air. And he says, Lord, if you are there, my heart desire is for me to meet this preacher. I want to ask this preacher the question. How did he know that the woman had a handkerchief? And where the handkerchief was? And how did he know that putting a handkerchief will do the things that the doctors have failed to do? The infidel says, Brother Mure, the infidel says, that's my heart desire. Bring me in contact with that man. I want to meet that man. So here, Brother Branham comes to his home. This time, not in a suit. My brother, it doesn't take you to wear a suit to win a soul. Brother Mure, even in your overalls, you can win souls. Brother Bernard, Brother Nguna, even when you are in your driving gear, you are wearing a work suit, you can win a soul to Christ. Even when you are in your apron, even when you are in your school uniform. Sunday school girls. That's why our school uniforms, they should be that of believers. They are quiet. Niti. Even your uniform must not fly up high. You must still be a Christian. Even when you are going to school. Shire corner. Hallelujah. Don't be a Jezebel when you are going to school. Still cover yourself. All right, I will pass that one. But you heard it. Hallelujah. Amen. Now, he had a desire. I want to meet that man. There is Brother Branham in dirty clothes, in hunting clothes. And then he starts to say, you ministers, you're nothing. But there is only one I want to meet. And Brother Woods wants to say, this is the one. And then Brother Branham says, not at the moment. Manage the information. All right. What happened? And then they started talking. So the man had apple trees. Hallelujah. And then Brother Branham says, please, can I have these nice golden apples that you have here? Then he says, I'll eat them. If you don't eat them, the insects are eating them. So he starts eating the apple. And he says, these apples are very nice. He says, yes, I've planted these trees so many years ago. He says, I see now it's almost getting to winter time. And I see the leaves are starting to drop. He says, it happens every winter. He says, but what intelligence tells the leaves that winter is coming? Then the leaves have got to drop down. Hallelujah. And the life, the sap of the tree, has got to go down and hide in the roots. And the man says, what did you say? He says, what intelligence tells the tree to hide the life of the tree in the roots because winter is coming. If the life remains up there in the tree will dry. He says, I've never thought of it, you know. He says, you think that it's nature? If it's nature, let's have a pole that we can dig, a wooden pole. Let's put it down and let's see it hiding the life to the roots. It can't do it. That tree is alive. It has got a life. It has got an intelligence. He says, that same intelligence is the one that told me about the handkerchief. Is the one that told me about the woman who was sick. And the man says, are you that preacher? Are you that preacher? He says, right there, on a simple thing like that, I led the man to Christ and baptized him. And he became a believer. No more dogs barking at the wrong tree. He had found something real. Brother, sister, the world up there, Sakane out there, is looking for something real. Something that has got life in it. Something that is true. Something that is genuine. And you will find people that you never thought would repent. You will see them repenting. Hallelujah. He says, after they finished, he became a Christian, baptized and everything, serving God in his community. And you know what? God is gracious. He was only left with 1 year. All these other years, he lived as an infidel. But in his last year, God brought the true message to him. He had a desire to say, I wish I could speak to that preacher. And I want to say to you, brother, sister, when you have a desire for something great, God has got a way of bringing that desire to you. I have a desire to see the supernatural working in our church, bringing in the lost souls. I believe if God honored the prayer of an infidel and brought brother Branham to him, how much more to the bride of Jesus Christ? How much more to you, Brother Mure? How much more is it for God to heal your children? How much more is it, church, for the power of the Holy Ghost that God has promised for those that believe him? Hallelujah. We have heard about Rosella Griffith. Who knows Rosella Griffith? She was a drunkard. When a man is drinking, we say, okay, it's expected. But what about when you meet a woman drunkard? It's worse, isn't it? And alcohol, anonymous, and all the people, they tried to help her. They couldn't help her. But just one meeting, and she was called by the Holy Ghost. Rosella Griffith, God has conquered your drinking habit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, let me preach in this hot afternoon and say, God is going to conquer that habit that is troubling you. God is going to conquer the habit of, bad videos. God is going to conquer the habit of boyfriends and girlfriends. God is going to conquer the habit of the things of the world. Hallelujah. When God conquers it for you, brother, you are now the king now. You are stepping on it. The things I used to do, I do them no more. The places I used to go, I go there no more. The answer I used to drink, I now drink Red Bull. Glory to God. The places I used to go, I go there no more. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. As our musician come, let's give a hand of praise to the Lord. Sister Pule, it takes the power of God. Let's just bless that woman. It takes the power of God to break some habits. Let's connect spiritually. You know the habit I'm talking about. It's not yours. It's for that one. It takes the power of the Holy Spirit to break that habit. Saints, you are not with me. It takes the power of the Holy Ghost. Sister Beulah, it takes the power of the Holy Ghost to break down the habits, to conquer the thing. Hallelujah. 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 Sister Nguna, it takes the power of the Holy Spirit to break down habits. Brother Chireka, it takes the power of the Holy Ghost to break down habits. Sister Mindy, it takes the power of the Holy Ghost to break down habits, to conquer the thing for you. Brother Nome, you can't conquer it for yourself. You can't conquer it for yourself. Young brother, you can't conquer it for yourself. Young sister, you can't conquer it for yourself. Give us a song. Give us a song. You can't conquer it for yourself. Only believe on the organ. Hallelujah. You can't conquer it yourself. You can't heal yourself of sugar diabetes. You can't heal yourself of the things of the world. It takes a supernatural power to break the thing. And brother, sister, we are looking for that. Before we get it out there, I want it right here. Jesus breaks every fetter. Jesus breaks every fetter. Jesus breaks high blood sugar diabetes. Hallelujah. You name it, God can break it. God conquers it for you. My brother, my sister, I am a living testimony. I did not grow up like this. I was once under the habit of the devil. But there is a power that came in my life, and it broke the fetters of the devil. And that same power, I give it to you. Jesus breaks every fetter. Hallelujah. There are some fetters of poverty, of stagnation. You are just in a circle. Your life is not going anywhere. Jesus breaks every fetter. The Hansa I used to drink, I drink it no more. The Premier League, Soccer League I used to follow, I follow it no more. The short dresses I used to wear, and for brothers, the tight trousers and the shorts and the vest. Those ones I now wear them in the bedroom. Hallelujah. Jesus breaks every fetter. Jesus breaks every fetter. Jesus breaks every fetter. Give us the songs, brother. Jesus breaks every fetter. Jesus breaks every fetter. Let's bow our heads now. Jesus breaks every fetter, for he set me free. Your chair can be your altar there. I am now on Raise your hand if you say, Jesus, I want you to break my fetters. I am now on the altar which was made for me. Jesus breaks every fetter. Break the fetter on our Sunday school, Lord. Jesus, break every fetter. Jesus, break every fetter. I will never doubt my Savior. I will never doubt my Savior. I will never doubt my Savior, your cleanses me. As the music just goes on like that, sweetly and softly like that. You think we are talking about what happened in India? What happened in Durban? What happened to this infidel? No, we are talking about today. We are talking about your family. We are talking about you. No matter what kind of a chain is pressing you or is tying you, I'm here to tell you, brother, sister, Jesus breaks every fetter. Jesus breaks every chain. He breaks the chain of circumstances. He has broken our chain where we were in captivity there. And he can break the chain in your life. He can break the chain in the Sunday school, brother and sister. You can be completely saved. There's a God who can heal alcoholism. He demonstrated it with Rosella Griffith. I don't care what kind of a habit it is, but in the presence of the pillar of fire, Jesus breaks every fetter. Just believe, my brother, my sister. Lord, I know you are pleased. Lord, I know you are here. And you see the chains. You see the fetters, the Heavenly Father, that need to be broken. Remember the families that are here, Lord. Remember the individuals that are here, Lord. Break every fetter. Break every fetter, Lord Jesus. Break the habits. Break the coldness. These cold form of spirits, we don't need them in church. Help us, dear God. You promise, Lord, to deliver families. Others are bound by alcoholism. Others are bound by the things of this world. But Father, here are people believing that you break every fetter. May someone go back home and find the situation changed. and find signs that God has already started working. Lord, are we like the dogs that infidel was talking about? Do we know what we are preaching, Lord? Are we barking at the wrong tree? If you are able to deliver the way you used to do it in the Bible, in the message, here are situations behind us. Come in a special way. I know you can do it, Lord. Restore family unit. Restore family relations. Cut that band, Heavenly Father. Where the devil is lying on, the way the devil is holding on, we refuse him in our church. We claim every brother. We claim every sister. We claim the Sunday school. We claim everybody, Heavenly Father. We pray, Father, cut and break loose the influence of the devil so that we can worship you freely. Father, even for our survival here,